I'm Barnyard. With me, I have the man that never has a plan, Daniel. I have Aaron Dingleberry in the back. We got Britt, who's asleep. And we got one of our friends, Cody, who's in the military.
Hey.
And, hey, welcome aboard. We just got out of Jordan Peele's directorial debut.
We just got out.
That movie was actually pretty enjoyable, in my opinion.
Yeah, better than I thought it was going to be.
Definitely.
Daniel?
I have no idea what to make of this movie.
Okay.
Stories about this guy, Chris, who's meeting his girlfriend's parents for the first time, and she's neglected to tell them that he's black, which is a source of discomfort for him. They live out secluded in the middle of the fucking woods, and whenever he gets there, they're overly nice to him, and they make it a point to kind of highlight how black he is. The dad's played by Bradley Whitford, yeah. Who is who's my favorite character on The West Wing, and he's great here. Hey, yo, my man, what's up? I would have voted for Obama a third term.
Damn, how racist are you trying not to look right now?
it's pandering dialogue that, you know, obviously gets him weirded out and kind of put on edge. And just the movie is developing that weird feeling that he's getting around being black until some shit just gets off the goddamn fucking wall. The best parts of this movie remind me of Alfred Hitchcock and Stanley Kubrick.
Yeah.
The worst parts remind me of Keanu. You know what? We can't really go much any further. Spoiler alert, we're going to be talking about this movie in detail, so if you haven't seen it yet and you just want to know our final thoughts and scores out of 6 stars, please scroll to the time code right there where he's fondling and have yourself a good old time. Otherwise, enjoy.
I was doing that.
Like when the black dude's talking to Chris, she like suck her balls or something?
she lick her balls or something?
I'll say this, because every single review's been saying this. The guy that plays Chris's best friend,
Rodman,
Lil Ray, is fucking amazing. That dude made the movie. What's cool about this movie is the way it takes its time.
Yeah.
That you don't know a lot. The editing's actually really good in the first two acts of this, because you're bouncing a lot from him dealing with the issues at the house, his suspicions about people, seeing like the family reveal little bits and pieces of weird shit, and then occasionally it'll bounce back to the TSA guy and he'll provide some comic relief. And so I like the way all these things are balanced out.
Yeah.
You never really get a good grip on this movie until maybe about 20 minutes from the end, which I think is a nice way to go.
It's where everything wraps up together and is the final course.
I thought the supporting cast was fucking great.
Oh yeah, dude. Yeah.
Like, Whitford, the lady that plays the mom is really good. Mm-hmm. I actually really love the guy that plays the girlfriend's brother. I don't know who he is. I think I've seen him before.
I thought it was a dude from Home Alone. I was like, no.
So did I! I wasn't the only one who thought it was Macaulay Culkin with fucking hair dye. Awesome! The first time you see him, where he's like being fucking really weird, asking about like MMA and shit.
Yeah. I think he was more looking like aggression, like, hey, are you into people beating the fuck out of each other?
Trying to imply a more darker side of it, where it's kind of like, because he's black, I think it's history. Kind of are you violent?
Pretty much. I got a little bit of that, but it was.
Caleb Landry Jones, that's the guy who played the brother. He was Banshee in First Class.
Oh, fuck.
That was his only recognizable role.
Oh, fuck. Yeah, he was. He looks like a fucking meth addict in this.
I know, dude. I went to him and was like, hey, what fucking drug do you think he's on?
I straight up took coke.
Dude, I said, like, fucking...
I thought you said all the drugs.
Ativan. No, I said coke. Fucking... Any psychotic drug?
Antipsychotic? Man, Adderall, coke, anything else we're missing?
Mountain fucking dew. The people that played the servants, I thought were fucking great.
I know, dude. I've seen the ladies.
Betty Gabriel?
Yeah.
What else is she in?
I don't know, but I've seen her. Wait.
No, American Horror Story? Is that her?
No.
What was she in?
She was in The Purge. Anarchy.
Wasn't she in Election Year?
Yeah, Election Year.
Yeah,
she was the badass chick.
She was the one with the badass driver.
Yeah, okay, I remember.
Who was part of the underground.
What made me notice is that Jordan Peele is an actor's director. Because he gets performances out of people that are just fucking haunting. You can't reveal a lot, but you gotta keep these people going. And just the way they move, like that scene in the trailer where the big, I guess the gardener, you call it, the groundskeeper, he's running straight towards Chris and then just takes a quick 90 degree turn. I'm sitting there like, what the fuck was that?
Oh shit.
Why the fuck was that?
I'm sure everyone thought this, but I was just the first one to, you know, point it out. Well, before we even saw the movie, I was telling Brittany, I was like, oh, that girl's totally fucking in on it. In on anything that's going on with the parents, and sure enough, that was correct. At this moment, they just went on a walk because Chris needed to get some air away from the people, and he was contemplating leaving and stuff. And while he's talking with Rose in the woods by the lake, you just see Dean, with everyone playing
Dean. Oh, the dad.
And he was just going, people holding up bingo cards. He went people up holding bingo cards. See a portrait of Chris, and you're like, oh, he's fucking auctioning him off. Yeah. That kind of escalated things very abruptly. And Chris is ready to go. He's like packing up his shit. There's this door that's open in Rose's room, and he goes and he looks in the box, and it's pictures of Rose with all these different black dudes.
And keep in mind, she said that he's the only black dude she's ever dated.
You just see the black dudes, and then you see the Andre guy, the guy with the hat that freaks out in the trailer.
It was the groundskeeper, and then it was the girl wearing the same hairstyle that she did in election year, so it should have clicked for me.
He gets this idea that Rose is in on it, but in his mind, he's probably like, she's probably hitting ties to do this, yada, yada, yada. Mm-hmm. And so he's like, Rose, we gotta get out of here. And she was like, Rose, where's the keys? Rose, where's the keys?
She's acting like, oh, I can't find the keys. How hard is it to find it in your purse? Come on now.
And then finally she
And you see the family start kind of ganging
yeah.
up.
And then finally she's just like, oh, really? You think it'll take me that long to find the keys?
At that point, the whole tone of the movie changed.
Yeah.
What was really great was that it caught our whole audience by surprise, the fact that she was evil. I'm like, are you fucking kidding me?
I was like, could you not tell by the pictures? I was like, you fucks!
It was the way she was talking to him as calmly as the parents were. We already kind of have an idea that the parents are crazy, and she's talking the same way, like, oh, I don't see this at all. And you know, you could chalk that up to her not experiencing the kind of shit that he does. That being a black man, experiencing some weird shit, he thinks of it differently than she does because she doesn't have experience. That's part of the commentary here. But me, I'm just sitting there like, oh, that bitch is evil. Like, I know for a goddamn fact that chick is evil. My favorite scene in the entire movie is the first time when he meets the mom in the chair. The mom is a psychiatrist who's known to use hypnosis to help cure her patients. The example they use is of smoking. So he goes out for a smoke. Off the bat, already sees some weird shit with the groundskeeper and the maid lady. Comes back in the house, sees the mom waiting up for him, and she sort of just kind of lures him into this hypnosis session. This is why I say Jordan Peele's an actor's director, because the way that scene goes out is so slow, but it works so goddamn well. Mm-hmm. She lures him in. It lures you in, because he starts off with, oh, no, I'm fine, no hypnosis, and she starts slowly leading him in. They say, yeah, we use focal points to kind of get people prepared and in the mental state. And as she's doing this, she's moving the spoon around this teacup and it starts clinging. The sound design in this movie is fucking great.
Oh yeah.
And that was one of the things that made me think of Hitchcock. But she starts kind of spinning this tea and cling, cling, cling. And it doesn't get you and it doesn't get him at first until it's too late, until you're already in the scene. She's hypnotized him. She forces him to remember the most vulnerable point of his life, which is the day that his mom died. And he recalls his big thing is that he was watching TV and he was so paralyzed by fear, he didn't do anything. Just because he didn't want to accept that something terrible might be happening. And so she locks on this vulnerable point, hypnotizes him, and he becomes paralyzed because he's stuck in that idea of his mom. Mm-hmm. And then when she finally says, sink into the floor, and he just sends him into this sort of like Twilight Zone dimension with like a tiny box up top. And I didn't know what that was at first until I thought back to the TV. That sort of isolation is it's a shot like I've never seen in a movie. They've kidnapped all these people as, I guess, a form of evolution that they're trying to...
The Caligula or whatever the fuck it was called.
It's called some coagula method. Yeah, coagula. The idea is that they pick people whose attributes, physical, mental, artistic, otherwise, are desirable. And so what they do is they take chunks out of their brains and kind of transplant it with everyone else to the point where the black person is able to move. They're zombies, essentially.
Yeah.
And the white person gets all the traits that are desirable. They want everything good about being black without everything that's a terrible way to explain it, and I'm sorry.
Like the way the cop asked for his ID in the beginning of the movie.
The problems that you get with having a different skin color, like being hassled by the police, having people constantly bring up race in conversation when it really doesn't need to be. But everyone's all like, oh, I love jazz, I love basketball, I love wearing dreads. Like, people want black culture without taking in all the negatives.
The mind of the person is going into the new body. They're still in there, but they're not in control. They're more like zombies, but they still have some of the, you know, mindset and some of the memories of the old people. Next step of evolution is able to live longer with your conscience in another younger body. And they've chosen to do it with black people. How they act like zombies, kind of, in the first two acts, kind of doesn't really support that theory. But whenever Rose was saying, you know, oh, you know, grandma, you know, the woman's in the car, you know, she automatically goes chases him, and she calls the groundskeeper grandpa.
The system they go through is so complex, they do all this, but yet, all of a sudden you see one little flash from a camera. All of a sudden it sets, it's like they jump out of it.
I don't think the movie does itself a lot of justice near the end, because it does get confusing. Like, at one point when he does the camera flash thing, the guy charges him and attacks, but on the other end, it's like the black guy comes back in control for a while and shoots the crazy girlfriend. I think what ends up happening is near the end of this movie, they kind of just make up what they need to push the story along.
Yeah.
There's a lot of loose threads that are thrown out, and just, I didn't really buy a lot of it. A lot of it looked really silly. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't get what the deer thing was about.
With Chris hitting the deer and then him, yeah, you know, thinking about it and stuff.
Him having a lot of flashbacks back to that dead deer.
Maybe because his mom hit and run.
Okay.
That's where I was thinking too.
Yeah.
There's a lot of weird shit that Jordan Peele chooses to do. In the fight scene between him and the brother at the end, they just have these weird shots of his hand going for the doorknob, mm-hmm, in the middle of this really big fight, and it kind of amounts to nothing. I don't know if that's supposed to be tension.
I guess he was trying to get outside.
He's trying to grab the door so he can kick it.
Yeah,
he's stabbing him in the knee.
I don't think he's trying to go stab him in the knee.
That wasn't the first intention, but he noticed he was doing that, and then he was like, oh, I could do the...
I guess, but it's just such a weird way to...
Yeah.
It's a weird thing to add in that kind of scene. And also what I found weird is, this movie's rated R, but there's a lot of off-screen death.
With the mom, yeah, we didn't... All we did was hear it.
And the brother. He gives the brother an American History X curb stomp, but you never see it. But it's just weird shit. And I guess it's kind of like a first-time director thing that... He's just trying a lot of stuff out that maybe isn't quite working out. I got a Rear Window vibe whenever you see Chris kind of looking through the camera, kind of like stalking people through the lens. Whenever you see the scene at the end, him inside this chair in the basement, everything's framed symmetrically like a Kubrick film would be. And I noticed a lot in the cinematography, in the tension that was kind of slowly cranked up. There is a lot of Hitchcock in this. I guess the last thing we really kind of need to talk about with this is, what y'all think of the racial commentary?
during the whole meeting of the big get together or whatever it was, whenever, you know, all these old white people were like observing Chris, it's like, oh, you know, black's in fashion now, and like, oh, you know, oh, your muscles, oh, is it really bigger down there, and all that was fucking cringeworthy. And I was like, why the fuck are they doing this? They're trying so hard to not sound racist. But then again, whenever the end comes and you're like, oh, these people were actually like trying to examine him and see what, you know, and see if there was worth the money.
They already gave off that vibe toward the beginning too, when they showed like the groundskeeper and the housemaid, how they were already black, and Chris was like, wait a minute. It's kind of racist because it's kind of like saying, okay, technically they're slaves, but you don't necessarily know they're slaves on there yet.
Like, all you know is that they're servants, yeah.
So servants, until the end you see, oh shoot, they are actually slaves on there. Technically, hypnotized.
Zombies.
Lobotomized.
Maybe it's like, here are these stereotypes, and do you hear how weird this sounds? This is kind of like normal shit that like some people are just say it kind of just to seem cool, you know, it's sort of like that nice, that overly nice trying not to offend you because you're black, but worrying about your blackness rather than who you are. And so I guess it's Peele trying to say like, do you hear how weird this shit sounds? Like, let me take this as far as it can go. Like, all this weird shit that I hear, it sounds like you're examining me.
It was one of those WTF movies, like, wait a minute. Think, okay, I got it, and then you're like, wait, what? Like, right as you start to piece it together, something, like, goes completely right, and you're like, oh, I don't got it now.
I feel like this one's probably gonna be one that I'm probably gonna need to watch again, but not for a while.
I don't feel like I could come back again this weekend and watch it again.
No.
Maybe in a few weeks, maybe a month.
Yeah.
It does deserve some further examination, maybe with a DVD or something.
Yeah, I guess for myself, I wouldn't, but for an audience, this works really well. The audience that we had in there fucking loved
it. Oh yeah, it was funny.
They had a lot of, they had a fucking blast. And I guess if you're just wanting to go to really kind of like let yourself get lost in a weird ass horror movie with a healthy dose of comedy, then this will probably be your jam.
If you scroll to our time code, welcome to our spoiler free part of the review.
We will be succumbing to tuberculosis in this part. This is unfortunately our last video, our 99th video.
Quarantine.
Rating this movie is gonna be hard, because I didn't really know how to feel about a lot of it. I love it when it's creepy and kind of doing its own thing. I'm kind of bored with it when it just kind of veers off. I didn't really think the comedy hit that well for me. When it was creepy, it was genuinely creepy, and then when it got comedic, it kind of lost some of that edge for me.
Yeah.
The story is convoluted as fuck, especially the third act. I think it's messy as shit. It's a really well-made movie. I love the cinematography. I love a lot of the close-ups. I love the color schemes. I like the symmetry and the weirdness of it. I like the inventiveness of the kind of him sinking into the floor. That was really cool shit. I feel like this is a movie I'm either gonna warm up to, or it's just gonna be something I never watch again. I'm probably gonna go 3.5.
3.5, alright.
Yeah.
Cody, how about you? Final thoughts and score of 6 stars.
This movie was one of those, it was kind of like up and down. It wasn't bad, it also wasn't the best either. It kept taking plot twists, turns left and right. It's so good, it's like you couldn't put your head around it. At the same time, you're like, wait a minute, why are they doing this, or this doesn't make any sense, especially some of the screenshots they do. Some of it, in my opinion, was irrelevant. Like, why do we need some of these scenes, like the deer, for example?
Yeah.
Why do we need that? What is that trying to signify? For my rating, I'll give it 3 stars.
3 stars.
I'll give it 3 stars.
Aaron?
For me, I personally didn't want to see this movie. I thought it looked stupid as hell. I was maybe $7 movie. Worth every penny I paid for a ticket.
Did you pay for a ticket?
This movie's worth dick!
Well, I enjoyed it the whole time. I love the fact that they had jump scares in there, and one part, Cody went, oh shit!
Yeah, that part. And he said, oh shit, everyone in the theater started laughing. That was funny as fuck, dude.
And once it all calmed down, another one happened, a guy a couple rows in front of us went, oh shit! Oh shit! Oh shit! the plot twist, I'm gonna give it a 5.
5?
Hey.
I really wanted to go see this movie, and I'm glad I did. For Jordan Peele's directorial debut, I believe it's his debut.
Yeah, it is.
Okay. I thought it was very well paced. You know, some of the cringiness of the second act was... It made sense more toward in the third act. I thought everyone who was in this movie gave a pretty damn good performance. And... Oh, man. I was legitimately thinking about giving this a 6-star. Because I enjoyed it that much. But if you were listening to us in our spoiler part of the review, we were talking about the third act and what... And we were discussing what the whole part of it was. It does seem a little more sci-fi-y, and it kind of took away from that suspense thriller because you didn't think it would be, you know, that weird. The sound design, it was creepy, and then it was joyful, and it was like, oh, it was cool. And, oh, man.
Something I really liked about this, too, is that, you know how in modern movies the jump scare noises are like this huge blast of, like, synth?
Yep.
Yeah, this one had, like, sharp piano strings. Yeah. And it reminded me of Hitchcock a lot. Yeah.
I can see why this has been getting, with critics, of course, 100% on Rotten Tomatoes. I really want to, but I don't feel like I can give it a 6. I'll give it a 5.5.
Half-cock verdict of 4.25 out of 6 stars.
You just had it up me one.
It's something that, you know what? Go check this out in theaters. Because movies like this don't get made often. This is one of those rare movies that's weird as fuck, it's original, and it's got a distinct voice to it, and that I really like.
One of the problems I thought this movie would have was that it was going to be like, you know, very racially... targeted, you know, hey, white people are like this. Of course, there were a group of them who were evil, but I was kind of glad that it didn't really go that route.
Peele's smarter.
Yeah, I know.
You watch Key and Peele.
Oh, like, I love them.
Both those guys are way smarter than that.
I know.
They know.
And that's why I'm glad it kind of went that route.
Yeah.
And, yeah, man.
Yeah, definitely support this kind of filmmaking. If y'all like this video, please click the like button. Subscribe if you want to be the first to find out when we got new videos up. Social media, we got Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Links are below. Liam's blog is liammgohan.wordpress.com. Our friend Noah is the Cinema Geek on Instagram.
Support the troops.
USA.
Support USA. The fucking USA. Troops, man. Fuck yeah. Thank you, buddy, for coming on set. We really appreciate you being here.
On set.
Yeah, on set in my illustrious Camry.
All you need is lights and a camera.
And you can do what we do. And a shitty sense of humor, and you can do exactly... And a desperation to be cool.
Yeah.
You also need to be a whore and promote yourself to random strangers on the street.
So this just dawned on me. Was it this movie or another movie where it showed a skeleton of a deer in the trailer?
It was this movie.
This movie? It was not even in the movie.
Skeleton of a deer?
Yeah. It's one of the last shots in the trailer. It's not in it. I feel like that's something that probably was just fixed at the very last second in the editing room. Like, okay, that's a little too far. Let's just kind of dial it back. For a second, I thought I was going to go Evil Dead 2 and the deer head was going to move like...
I did too. That would have been funny.
I would have loved it.
Especially like in the hypnotic scenes.
That would have been creepy as shit.
It's looking at an angle and just slowly straightens its head out towards you.
I think this is the only movie that's coming out this week.
I think this is the only movie we give a shit about that's coming out this week.
We still need to watch Cure for Wellness.
Yeah.
Maybe Fist Fight.
Fist Fight is terrible.
Well, we gotta see it.
No, we don't.
We'll do a 17-second review like we did on Office Party. We have Logan next week.
Fuck yeah! Fuck yeah! Logan next week, bitches!
Oh, we got Kong on Wednesday.
Yeah.
I'm off that night, so yeah, we're good.
Does it say Life of a Zucchini?
My Life is a Zucchini. It's the Academy Award nominated animated feature. I don't know what it's about, but I know the title makes me want to watch it. Just because it looks weird as shit. Alright, I'm tired of shit. I gotta go.
1:30 in the morning.
1:30 in the morning. Go see this with an audience. Have a blast. Thank you guys very, very much for watching. Take care, and have a good night. See ya!
Get out.